And Father, as we now come to the opportunity to listen to your word, we ask that our ears will be attuned to your voice, our hearts will be attuned to your heart, and that we will hear distinctly what you are saying to us today. We thank you and honor you for this day, for this is the day that you have made, and you've given us the ability to rejoice and to be glad in it. And we thank you for all things. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. We are closing out, as we get close to the actual day of celebration of Martin Luther and him putting the 95 theses upon the wall, the door of the church. And we have talked about sola scriptura, which is scripture only, scripture alone. Sola gratia, grace alone. Sola fide, faith alone. Sola Christus, Christ alone. Then we looked at the effect that those focuses, those four points of focus caused us to have, and what it did for us. It made us peculiar. It made us holy. It made us a people that were not a people. It changed our lives. And it brings us now to the final point of the five. And this one is soli Deo Gloria. Soli, S-O-L-I, Deo, D-E-O, Gloria, G-L-O-R-I-A. Soli Deo Gloria. Only God gets the glory. God alone gets the glory. And as we look at this today, we're going to go to 1 Corinthians, the 10th chapter, starting at the 23rd verse to the end. And it starts off like this. You say I'm allowed to do anything, but not everything is good for you. You say I'm allowed to do anything, but not everything is beneficial. Don't be concerned for your own good, but for the good of others. So you may eat any meat that is sold in the marketplace without raising questions of conscience. For the earth is the Lord's and everything in it. If someone who isn't a believer asks you home for dinner, accept the invitation if you want to. Eat whatever is offered to you without raising questions of conscience. But suppose someone tells you this meat was offered to an idol. Don't eat it out of consideration for the conscience of the one who told you. It might not be a matter of conscience for you, but it is for the other person. For why should my freedom be limited by what someone else thinks? If I can thank God for the food and enjoy it, why should I be condemned for eating it? For whatever you eat or drink or whatever you do, do it all for the glory of God. Don't give offense to Jews or Gentiles or the church of God. I too try to please everyone in everything I do. I don't just do what is best for me. I do what is best for others so that they may be saved. May be saved. One of the presidents, I can't remember which one off the top of my head, said that anything can be accomplished if we don't concern ourselves with who gets the recognition. Anything can be accomplished if we don't concern ourselves with who gets the recognition. And so Paul here has just talked to the Corinthians, them people. The Corinthians were so saved that they just didn't understand what they were actually doing. The Corinthians were celebrating the fact that they were still serving God and allowing craziness to go on in their church. So Paul had to write them a letter. And when we get to verse number 10, Paul brings out the fact that you can't eat at God's table and the devil's table at the same time. You're eating at one or the other. And so he then goes on and he says, if you are the Christian, then why, if we know that the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, are you concerned about how or what that meat had been through? It almost brings out the fact that if you had $20 in your hand and someone said, you know, that $20 was used in a drug deal, would you throw that $20 away? Y'all laughing. It was used in a drug deal. But you saying to yourself right now, I ain't using it in no drug deal. That's $20. I need this $20. And Paul was saying even further than that, let's look at this. If the meat was offered to an idol, did the idol eat it? I don't think it did. I don't think the idol could eat. But his point in this is the fact that if this is an offense to someone else, then don't be offensive. If someone else says, you know that $20 was using a drug deal, then don't use that $20 in front of that person. Don't cause that other person to have an issue with you. You're spending drug money. I really want this to sink in, because once we understand that, then we can get to the main point. Soli Deo Gloria. So if we understand that the only purpose that we should be having is this, that God gets the glory. It doesn't matter. It's not a point of contention in who gets the glory except when it comes to God. And as we look at this, Paul, then he says, you know, you're always talking about I'm allowed to do anything. Grace allows me to do anything. I got grace. Grace. But everything isn't good for you. Everything is not beneficial for you. It sounds like Paul would say something like my grandmother would tell us, you better act like you got some sense. Just because you can doesn't necessarily mean that you should. You could run on the highway. But I don't think you can get up to 60, 70 miles an hour. And if you're on 85, Highway 85, then you might need to exceed that speed. But I don't think a human body can do that. So you will end up probably causing an accident. You may have the ability, but that doesn't necessarily mean that you should do it. We want this to resonate in you that because there are some freedoms that you have as being a Christian, along with freedom comes a word called responsibility. Freedom has a responsibility. And that's why Paul then says, listen, yes, you can do anything. But don't be so wrapped up on what you can do. Let's look at how we can be a benefit to others. In this congregation, we're always talking about we are blessed to be a blessing. We are blessed to be a blessing. And so he's using as the point in this set of scriptures, he's looking at, hey, you go over to a friend's house to eat, and you chose to go, and the friend offers you something to eat. Eat it. Don't sit there and say, is this meat been offered to idols? Don't go through all that nonsense. It says, because the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. Everything, if you're walking in the promises of God, then everything you touch is blessed because you are a blessed vessel. I heard one guy say, that's why sometimes he says, I don't have to say a blessing over my food because I'm a blessed man, and if I touch it, it's blessed. That's another way to look at it. Everything that you touch is blessed, so you don't have to say a blessing over you. Whatever, you're just hungry, I guess. But anyway,
thank
you. So what we look at is, don't get yourself so tied up. Now, if you go with some other folks and they say, oh, you know that meat's been offered to idols, and it seems to be a point of contention for them, then his point is, then you don't eat the meat in front of them. That's like if you know somebody don't eat pork, and y'all eating breakfast, and you order a big old slice of country ham, and you sitting over there, and you just smacking on that ham, and they just looking at you, and you can tell it's bothering you. Why are you going to do that to that person? Why would you do that? Exactly. I can do anything, but everything's not beneficial. I can do anything. I'm allowed to do anything, but everything is not necessarily good for you. So we have to sometimes, most of the time, all the time, take the focus off ourselves and look at the effect that what we do has on those around us. Mm-hmm. Now, one of the funny things is this. I grew up with some guys. We're still very, very close. And we talk about how we go out and get our Boone's fine wine, because that's all we could afford, and just walk around together drinking. And so as we got older, and some of us started serving Christ earlier than others, it got to the point where they were like, well, I know you don't drink, so but we're getting ready to go to this party, so, you know, we're not, we understand if you don't want to come. No, I don't mind going to the party with you. I don't have to drink. And so, you can still be a part, but you don't have to take part. You can still go and be around your friends, because you still want to be the light. You still want to be the light. And then they'll get to the point, they'll say, well, you know, let's go. I don't want to keep you. They'll blame you. I don't want to keep you around all these folks that's drinking, you know. I don't want you to be tempted. But, you know, they're just like, well, he's still sinning and still be having fun. And I'm with all the drinking and stuff going on. But now, if you're not ready to go, then you just don't go. That's when you got to be honest with yourself and say, hey, I might take a little nip when I get there. Because when I first got, that's what I did. I was like, you know what? I ain't going. I ain't ready for it. I get up in there and I start smelling some things, and y'all be taking me to the house. And I'm supposed to be the example. So my best bet was not to go. So we just got to be wise in how we do things. And then he says, this is the bottom line. Verse number 31 says, so whether you eat or drink, or whatever you do. So he takes his eat and drinking, and then he says, or whatever you do, you have to do it all for the glory of God. Do it all for the glory of God. Mm-hmm. He says, don't give offense to the Jews. Don't give offense to the Gentiles. Don't give offense to the church of God. But we have to give all glory to God. All glory to God. All glory to God. We don't give glory to anyone else but to God. Because God's desire is for every person to be saved. And that, in turn, should be our desire. That everyone around us has a relationship with God. And so, as we look at the background of this and how this became one of the solas, it's the fact because we have to understand the ultimate goal of everything that God has created or done is so that he can be glorified. And that he wants to be glorified so that he can radiate even greater, so that more people will come to recognize who he is in their lives. Mm-hmm. When we do something, when we, our actions, our words, they always point out something. Our conduct causes folks to focus. Glory is showing a eminence, a light, a splendor toward something. So what we want to do is we want to put the spotlight, let's say, on God. Now, back in the day, the priest would say that if you're not a priest, then you can't show God glory. And they would say that there's something that's secular, and then there's something that's sacred. And they made this distorted two-tier system, meaning that ministerial work was holy and everything else was not. If you wasn't doing ministry work, you ain't holy. So Think about what that does to a person's mind. They want to do anything in order to be holy. They want to do anything to be right. It's the same thing as we were talking the other day about the caste system in India and how dominant that system is. That if you're born into the lower caste, it's nearly impossible for you to move up above that. And the same thing with this environment where if you're not the priest, if you're not the teacher, if you're not doing any ministerial work, not holy. You're just doing something. But we want to look at this, and in the midst of this, how God has designed this situation. When God designed it, he set it up so that what we say and what we do causes glory. What we say and what we do, not what we say in church and do in church, but everything that we say, everything that we do has an imminence of glory. And what Paul wants us to do is recognize that everything that we say and everything that we do has an imminence of glory, projects glory. What we want to do, how we want to do it is we want our glory that we are emanating, that we are projecting, to cause everyone to focus on God. Everything we say, everything we do. We've come up with this dualism that we walk one way in the midst of the church folks because that's holy. And we walk a different way when we're not around the church folks because it's secular. But God is saying there's no difference. I want you to be the same as on this side as you are on this side. I just want it to be the same. I want to get the glory in everything. So, God, you get the glory when I scrub the floor? If you do it as unto me. If you do it with a good attitude. Why do you think God had to have us say he loves a cheerful giver? Don't be like, there's some money for you, God. There you go. You have a different attitude. You project a different environment by how you say and how you do. Mm-hmm. So this is the point that we want to finally just drive home with you, is the fact that whatever you say, mm-hmm, whatever you do, provides glory. So if I'm not providing glory to God, who am I providing glory to? If I'm not providing glory to God, who am I providing glory to? What else am I illuminating? What else am I emanating if I'm not doing it for God? Now I'm going to tell you this, just so you can understand. It doesn't matter, because only things that you do for Christ are going to last. Only things that you do for the Father are going to have the right effect. If I'm glorifying myself, if I'm putting myself up on the pedestal, if I'm emulating myself, it's going to fall. If I'm emulating someone else and crediting and illuminating someone else, it's going to cut short. Sometimes our intentions are to always do good by folks, but sometimes we miss the mark. But God is always good.
Yes.
God is always faithful. God is always loving. God is always looking to help us to become more like Him. So if I'm having to scrub the floors, and if I think of it, God is getting glory from me scrubbing the floor, I might scrub them a little bit better, because I want God to get the glory. I want God to be pleased with what I'm doing. When I'm speaking to my children, when I'm speaking to my spouse, I want to give God the glory. So it might change how I put my sentences together and adjust the intonation that I use when I speak to my spouse and to my children. If I focus on giving God the glory, I think it may change everything about me. Because when we give God the glory, God shows up and God begins to work on our behalf. Because Paul said the reason we do this is because we want folks to come into the right relationship. We want folks to be saved. And that's why Paul wrote in Romans, the first chapter, that some folks come to salvation by what they see around them, their environment, and just begin to realize that there has to be something greater, a higher power, as they're now kind of posing it, and saying, there's something greater that I need something greater. And so I want to drop this in your lap before we go to the sticky note and say this. Do you treat your job as meaningless as you think it is? Or do you treat your job as a holy work unto the Lord? Don't raise your hand and don't answer that. That was for you to think about.
That's it.
I don't want you feeling guilty. Our sticky note for this week is this. You express glory in everything you say and do. You express glory in everything you say and do. You express glory in everything you say and do. If you want to personalize it so that you can say it to yourself during the week, just say, I express glory in everything I say and do. I express glory in everything I say and do. And then a hidden meaning in that is what? I want God to be glorified. I want God to know that I know He is glorified in everything that I say and I do. Let's pray. Father, we thank You for the opportunity to learn how we can give You glory. That is not only when we come together with other believers, but it's in everything that we say, everything that we do. So, Father, now we repent, even now, of how we looked at our jobs and maybe some of the things that we've said to our loved one, our spouse, or our children. We repent. Please forgive us. Renew our mind that we will go forward and speak words of life to our spouse and our loved ones and those that are around us. Give us a renewed insight and vigor, God, toward the work that we do, and that we will not look at it as meaningless, but as an opportunity to worship and serve You. Thank You, Father, for Your word. Holy Ghost, we ask that You'll touch us and remind us that we express glory in everything that we say and everything that we do. That we will fall into the mold, the mission of glorifying the Father. And so, God, we thank you for this day, and we thank you for all things. And we ask that this word that was declared, that its seed would fall into the good soil of our hearts and gain great root and raise up like a mighty oak beside the water, that you will be glorified. We thank you and honor you for it. In your Son, Jesus' name, amen.